and it seems like a week since we were last here.
As usual, I will be associated with Andrew first of all. Welcome to you, welcome to those who may be listening from the far-flung corners of the Underground Network
in Epping and Chesham and indeed all around the world. Most of these announcements I made last week, but the first one is slightly different. The last DStock is still going to be on Sunday the 7th of May, but the museum is now proposing to start bookings for that next Monday. They told me last week it'll be coming
Tuesday, it'll be Monday next week
at 10 o'clock. We'll get an email out for those of you who are on the email list reminding you of that, but it is expected to be a virtual quick sellout. So if you do want to come on the last DStock tour on Sunday the 7th of May, you'll need to be at the end of your phone or your laptops at 10 o'clock next Monday. Chronologically then, we move to the Depot Open Weekend, no change there, Saturday 22nd, 23rd of April, with the special opening of the Friends sales stall for Friends only on the Friday the 21st, between 12 and 6, just for sales from the sales stall. You won't get access to other parts of the depot.
12 and 4? 12
and 4, maybe
1600, 4 o'clock. Quite right.
And finally,
Saturday
the 23rd, our Saturday next meeting will be a
month away, or a month and a bit, which is on Monday the 8th of May. It's our annual members meeting, so we'll be presenting the annual accounts and various other documents for you, but hopefully that business will be dispatched relatively quickly, because we have a speaker presentation, second presentation from Nick Lehrer, who's taken us halfway through his presentation, The Wires End at Fulwell, and we now proceed, in fact, to Fulwell on what is actually the very anniversary of the withdrawal of trolleybuses on the 8th of May. Come for the AAM if you really want to, but certainly come for Nick Lehrer's talk.
Right, that's the end of
the Paris notices. It is left just for me to introduce Sir Peter, who really doesn't need any introduction whatsoever. You know him in his former role as Transport Commissioner, in his current role as Chairman of Network Rail. You know him as a lifelong transport enthusiast, as a friend, a member of the Friends, as a patron of the museum. And I think Peter, a member of the museum board again?
Yes, absolutely.
So very heavily connected, not only with this museum, but with transport heritage everywhere you go. So we're delighted he's found time in a fairly hectic schedule, I'm sure, to talk to us. And without further ado, I shall hand over to Sir Peter.
Thank you.
John asked me to talk about buses and bring some pictures. Now, I haven't brought any pictures,
I'm afraid, and it's an error of my own. It's not an error.
I couldn't do it because I had a really fun day
on Friday. We went out with the Wires Crossman to reopen
the Carlisle Railway, which is the chairman of the Network Rail.
Pitched
to July. The result was I got the weekend, so I couldn't do what John asked me to, which is to produce some representative pictures. So you'll have to wait for some other. Shouldn't really perform with children, technology, or animals because they quite frequently go wrong. All three of them. It's me. Back today because tomorrow morning I thought I might have to gap early and go somewhere, but we've those of you who might be interested, and some of you might be, we've organised the first ever recent seminar for charter train operators for Network Rail. These things are regarded, but at least by some people, as really difficult and get in the way of what's going on in the railway network. Actually, I don't think so. I think what we've proved, Mark Carl and I approved absolutely to our satisfaction is that, remembering that you've got the oldest railway in the world, that people love our railway, they love steam engines, is a very good way of creating public enthusiasm for a subject which usually in the media is notable for abject and whole criticism rather than celebration. So I took Mark on the inaugural run of the Flying Scotsman on the East Coast Main Line a year ago, and we were both blown away by the number of people who turned up to see the train, and it's certainly struck us ever since that in an environment where you don't get much good news, actually helping people to have fun and remember the history of the place is a really good thing to do. And there are, of course, parallels, because we've done it before, and you don't want me to talk about it because it's not supposed to be the subject, but actually running the steam train on the underground was the joy of my life, really, because we decided it could, and we did it, and wasn't it fantastic? So there we go, and I'm sure somebody will do it again, because once you've proved you can do something once, it's much easier. So Leon, who isn't here but has been my mate for a good 50 years or so, I'll steal one of his lines actually. He was speaking at the CPT dinner quite last autumn in substitution for some hapless politician who couldn't be bothered or couldn't turn up. And he said there are three ages in those things. The first age is when you go to one of those things and you don't know anybody, but you're in wonderment as to all the important people that you're bumping into, even though they don't know who you are. And then there's a second age where actually you are one of those people and you know them all and they all know you. And then thirdly, you get to the age where there are a lot of people there, you've got no idea who any of them are. They think you're important, but you don't know who they are because they're all and the truth is that actually I've got to that age pretty securely now. But I do know who you are because I've worked with most of you, so that's okay. And the other apology, I suppose, is that I do get asked to do this a bit now. I'm hoping not many of you went to the Omnibus Society London Historical Research Group last October at Palestra, but if you did, I will try to get through more than 5 years in an hour, because that promises to run to the point at which everybody will be dead before I get to the 21st century. That was a bit detailed, so I'll try and cover more years quicker. The other one that John asked me to talk to you about a bit, and I will mention something about it, providing there's time, and you can ask me if there isn't, is the bus service to Imber. Now, that is an illustrated talk that I do. I don't think any of you were in a disused church in Bristol where I did it, to the Church's Conservation Trust, 2 years ago. I did it at Lots last autumn with a whole load of pictures, and it is quite an interesting story. So one day, if you want it and there isn't sufficient duplication, you can have it, because that story is still continuing. The email traffic for August the 26th has already started, God help us. We're busy concocting new things to do in Imber, because it's quite fun to do. But I think the main purpose of John asking me, if there was a purpose other than the fact you were having a meeting and couldn't decide if anybody else could come, was to talk about this, what now seems to be... Oh dear, hang on. Don't see how I told you not to perform with technology. I think the main purpose is to talk about... the years that I've spent running in the bus industry, I suppose. So you should never perform the technology. Actually, if one of those rings, you'll have fun. But I thought what I would try to do is to give you some elements of a brief story up until about 1980, mid-1980s or so, and then talk about that a bit. Now actually, that of course is influenced by Roger Turaid's fantastic book. I came here to introduce it when he spoke to the friends. I think it's not quite the last word on the saga of privatisation, but it's not far off, because it's such a detailed such a detailed account. And the thing I like the most about Roger's book, actually, is that it's complete. There are parts of it which are inconsistent. And if you think about it, history is a bit inconsistent, because history is in the eye of the surviving people of the time, and not everybody had the same experience, and not everybody did well out of it, and some people's memories about what happened are completely different from ours. And I think Roger really captures that very well. Most history books try to sanitize it all so that you can see a continuum of this story in a way that isn't really actually the case. And I think one of the things that I admire about Roger's book is that where he got conflicting accounts, he actually left some of the conflict in, which is right, because there was some conflict at the time. And some of the rest of, I think, this story, frankly, you can have your own view on, because I've got quite a widely circulated public position on what the organisation was like when I first joined London Transport as a graduate trainee, and some of it is a bit of hype, but I think quite a lot of it is true. But I'm quite happy if people disagree with it. The only thing that I wouldn't do as a consequence of my own experience is to stand up at people's retirements and say it was all better in the old days, because actually I don't think it was, and I don't think it is now. And even with what Leon's having to cope with in terms of the traffic in London and a slight diminishment of the bus market, it's markedly better than it's been in probably my adult lifetime, if not in all of yours as well. But you're entitled to have a disagreement about what it looks like, and if you want to disagree with me afterwards in the questions and answers, then I'm very happy to do that. So if you take it back and I summarise what took a very long length of time at the Omnibus Society, I've been a bus enthusiast since I was about four, if I'm actually truthful, I wound up in my teenage school years in a school which took a trip to Loire Valley in France in an RTL which was owned by Continental Pioneer of Richmond. A very fine company, Tim Lewis, who's still a friend of mine, he used to run it. It's where I learned that you can run a business with a watch of £20 notes in your back pocket. That's both how people paid for the coach hire and how the drivers were paid generally. It was the most valuable experience you could have in an era when there was nothing like work experience, and an organisation like London Transport, you either had full-time work for or you didn't. And I was too young, and I didn't, and I was a schoolboy, and I learnt a lot there. I learnt a lot. In fact, I learnt particularly a lot about people who didn't like working for London Transport, because virtually the whole of their driving stock were people who'd left or been fired from an organisation that actually was clearly both rigorous in one sense and limited in its outlook in another. And of course, some of you will know they run a bus route, they run the 335 up Richmond Hill. And in the days when you could apply for a conductor's license, you didn't have to work for London Transport. You did have to be over 18, so I didn't, I got one. And I used to take the fares. I used to go down there after school sometimes in the evening, take the fares. There were no tickets. The accounting was pretty rudimentary. We didn't really run much of a timetable, but it was quite an interesting experience. And you learn a lot about how things work. And in particular, you learn a lot about the attitudes of people in the industry. And it struck me then, as it still strikes me now, that actually the hardware and all of the stuff about the routes and you know, the sort of grand history which this wonderful museum represents is one thing, but the attitude and the variety of people is quite another. And what struck me then, and it still strikes me now, is that since most people get into the transport industry by accident, then actually that cross-section of people who happen to turn up there either part or full-time to drive buses was no less hapless in a way than many of the people who worked for London Transport and became very senior. They just got into it and liked it and stayed, and still wherever I go on the railway, I ask people, A, how long they've been on the railway, because it's a good way of finding out, and generally I've been around for longer than they have, and B, I ask them why they got onto it, and apart from the people who are second, third and fourth generation railway people, the most surprisingly large number of people have got into it by accident, They wanted a vacation job, they didn't have anything to do, they just took a job on a row and decided it was okay. And actually the bus industry is clearly still a bit like that. I tried to work out once what percentage of the population of London we must have trained to be a bus driver in the last 50 years. And it must be measurable, mustn't it? If you look at the turnover and just add it all up. And some of those souls at Pioneer, I mean, frankly, one or two of them should never have been given a bloody licence in the first place. But they sort of did their best. And I learned some other things as well. LCBS used to send us tender forms for second-hand vehicles. So I said to Tim one day, I said, why don't we put in for some of these? He said, we haven't got any money. So I said, well, I'll put in 50 quid each for five of them. And we got four of them. We got four RS for 50 quid each, one of which had been recently overhauled. The one that we didn't get was a modernised RF, but it was all right because the engine was knackered. Just as well we didn't get that. But the other four were absolutely brilliant. And I think two of them are still around, actually. Some event at Buckingham Palace that one of them turned up inside the courtyard, which would have amazed both Tim Lewis and the patrons of the 235. So anyway, that was a good way of finding out about the bus industry. And then I went to university. I tried to get part-time work driving coaches in Leeds, but they made you get up too early in the morning for a student. So I didn't really try it that. It was better going back doing it in your holidays, really. Anyway, you earn more. So, and London Transport employed me as a graduate trainee in 1975. And one of the things that I think is a real story about this is that the attribution of this, I think, says a lot about the history of the organisation there are people in the audience would know more than I would about this. But the thing that I found completely extraordinary, as did Steve Clayton, who some of you will know, who went on to work for Arriva, who's still a good mate of mine, is that much though you thought you were going to join a transport organisation, the organisation thought that what you were going to do was administration and management. It didn't really seem to think you wanted to do much about transport. It seemed to think that you wanted to know about administrative things. And I did all the sorts of things that you would do as a trainee. But the best thing I did was to be a conductor at Riverside in the summer of 1976. It was notable for two things. One of which is I was the only person who had turned up for a very long time with a conductor's licence in the training school at Chiswick, of which more in a minute. But the other, it was a very hot summer, and for somebody of 23 on the back of a bus in the King's Road, it was pretty damn good, actually. if you knew when to get the fares in and when you didn't. And one of the things that actually struck me then, and it struck me later, I'm going to talk about it a bit more, is that by the time when I did that, Pioneer wasn't institutionalised at all. It was anarchic, really. But people realised that if you didn't bring enough money in, the place would go bust. But actually, that experience told me a lot about the way in which the organisation thought it did things and the way that people at the bottom actually did them. And the very first thing that you learned about being a conductor was that you filled in a time card and you never filled in any time which was earlier than what was on the time on the log sheet. You never filled it in earlier than what was on the time card. That was rule number one. It wasn't quite what they told you at the training school, but it didn't matter what they told you at the training school. What you did out there was you were never early, on paper at least. And there are all sorts of other rules which had become institutionalised. So the training was a sort of pastiche of real life as I look back on it. And then they sent you out, and I'd bloke called Peter Cattini, who I still know, who trained me to be a bus conductor, who used to work in a betting shop at Fulham subsequently. Really, really nice guy. And he sort of got these recruits out, and he sort of said, well, you're out now, so you forget all that crap that they told you in there. Now I'm going to show you how to do this job. And in about a week, he showed you how to do the job. And he wasn't bad at doing the job, but what was interesting was that his version of customer service was not a bad version of customer service. But it was really nothing like the training. The training was a sort of militaristic view about what you know, the privates would do under the general command of non-commissioned officers. And when you're out there by the 1970s, I mean, there were people doing what the bloody hell they liked. You know, running early, not running at all. I'll tell you a story about Holloway if we go on to it. And actually, it was really as though the organisation at the top thought one thing, and the people who trained you thought something else, and then out there it was something else completely. Riverside was actually a good place to work. It was an absolutely horrible place in terms of a building. But curiously, what I discovered, and some of you will already know, is that the worse the conditions were, the greater the spirit of the people in it. So actually, this horrible sort of early motor bus garage with no staff facilities and woeful engineering actually produced really quite a good service, except it didn't have enough staff, and the spirit of the staff there was really pretty good. And actually I really loved it. They were really friendly, you could sort of tell that it was going to be a good job. So that was okay. And then Steve and I got towards the end of our training, and we said, naively at first, but with more strength afterwards, we'd actually quite like to run buses. That's what we thought we'd join London Transport for. And to give some people who are still around, at least, no longer employed, obviously, their credit, Brian Gilbert and later Frank Giles were more responsive than we had any right to expect, actually. The organisation, in fact, Derek can tell me if I'm wrong, I don't think had taken graduate trainees into bus operating management for some considerable time. And they looked us up and down, worked out we were spotty ewes, but we might actually want to do something. We both did some work for Frank in the organisation of what became the eight districts in 1978, and then they were brave enough to set us off on another training scheme. There's nothing like a good training scheme for a long time. In 1978, in order to get into management, and I think looking back, that was pretty brave. Not because it wasn't the right thing to do, but because the organisation clearly hadn't done it for a long time. So I turned up. I worked for Ralph Bennett for a bit as his personal assistant. He became the chairman. I went to the chairman's office. I survived a decent encounter with Sue Howell, who's still a friend of mine. She didn't quite understand why you would need a personal assistant, but she survived me for 8 months, and then I went back to Chiswick to learn to drive. Now that was a real problem because I already knew how to drive. I had already got a PCV license. I got it at Pioneer. I took my test at Penton Street on an East Kent Region 5, which was really good fun. At the end of the test, the examiner said, "Well, you passed." I said, "Yeah, okay." He said, "But that's not the point. Can I have a go at this thing? I've never driven one of these." No, it's true, actually. And he couldn't brake smoothly. So I felt all right about that. But I already had a license, and that proved to be a really major problem for the training school. I failed. The LT test twice, actually, and I think if I'd been an ordinary recruit, they would have slung me out. Bill Maxwell used to send messages down to Brian Gilbert on a Friday saying, "Has Hendy failed another test yet?" And the answer was, "I normally had." But I could not drive. They wanted to take you apart and put you back together the way that London Transport taught you to drive, and I couldn't do it. It just seemed to me to be totally alien to try to beat everything out of you and then put it back again. And quite clearly, there were hundreds and hundreds of people who had licences, who'd been thrown out of the training school, who were apparently suitable to drive public service vehicles, but who were not allowed to drive London Transport one, because you couldn't drive the way that Chiswick told you to. And in the end, I had a test with a mousy little man called Beamish, who I reckon cost London Transport millions. He was the chief driving examiner. And he sort of, in the end, he sort of said to me in appropriate official language, "I don't really think you're any good, but I've been told that you've got the passes." Which might well have been true, actually. So I went back to Riverside, and that of course, was a more interesting time, because actually, as a conductor, actually hung about and did nothing. Drivers in West London at that time were so short of staff that actually you could virtually get any job you wanted. It was a good 3 months. And actually, I got a regular conductor. I got a guy called Jeff Berry, who I still know, who after conductors went on to be a parking attendant at Hammersmith and Fulham. He was a bright guy, actually. His daughter's a vice president of Morgan Stanley in New York, so he's no Joel. Jeff was no slouch, and he knew how to do this job as well. And then you remembered it all again, that you never ran early, or apparently never did on paper, and you did what some of the supervisors wanted, to the extent to which you wanted to, because you knew how they were rostered, and you knew whether or not they'd be there on the way back or not. And I was an odious bloke called Davis at Butterwick, who I was late one day, and he knew that I was a trainee, so he gave me Mansion House on the 11th instead of Liverpool Street. I must have been at least half an hour late, and I thought, well, stuff you. So I said to Jeff, we're going to do this. So we shot up to Liverpool Street. We never took a turn until we came back. I left the bus on Butterwick, a few people on it, going to Brook Green on the way back on time. Davis had disappeared, and we thought, well, we've shown him. We left all these people on the bus, and we got home on time. It didn't stop anywhere much, actually. But the point was that actually that was a pretty awful way to run the bus service, because that was about what the crews and the supervisors wanted, and they do what the passengers wanted. And indeed, I suppose what is a surprise after all these years somehow is that anything good came out of it. But there were loads and loads of people who were absolutely committed to doing a really difficult job in difficult circumstances at a time when, of course, actually a measurable proportion of the service wasn't running at all, and then until recently you had to have a pretty strong intellect to have worked out what the effect of your service control decisions was in hours 2 and 3, and some of them weren't good enough to do it, but even the people who were, you couldn't work it out completely, and the result was appalling holes in service and gap and bunching and all the other things, which I sort of proved when I became an inspector, because actually I have to confess that's a job I was lousy at, but it's all right, because along the way Alan Meacham, who ran Area 12 at Victoria, managed to put me in some places where I couldn't do too much damage. One of the places you couldn't do too much damage, in fact you couldn't do anything actually, was Tottenham Court Road on the 19s, because it was just in that bit of New Oxford Street, just when you come around the corner from Charing Cross Road. And you only saw them going one way. So actually, you could do quite a lot of damage, but the nice thing was that actually whatever damage you did, it never visited you again. Because by the time whatever you'd done either came round to hit you or not, it was about 4 hours later. The bloke southbound was, where was the southbound point? Can you remember? Yeah, it was completely bizarre, because you only saw northbound buses. And the other thing I learned about the 19 schedule is that, well, Derek again can, I'm sure it was fantastically efficient, but every bus did a different selection of journeys. So you couldn't work out what was coming, until you could see its running number, and when you did, unless you knew the schedule, you didn't know what it was doing. Your decisions were pretty random. You couldn't do much with the Holloway ones, because they were mostly going back on relief because it was such a long route. And if you did do something nasty, the one thing you could guarantee is you would never ever see them again, because they came from Holloway. And if they managed to get out that far, they'd probably never get back again. So it was all pretty random. What I did work out, though, and I think I said it before, is that some of those men, and they were principally men at that time who did that job, had the most astounding intellects and could make something out of nothing in circumstances where actually it would have been really, it was quite hard to do. That's the point. If you've got 20 or 25% of the service missing, trying to work out how to manipulate the remainder in a world where the rules stop you doing quite a lot of stuff and the schedule's so complicated really tested some of those people. And the surprise to me looking back on it is that many of them did so well. Not that it was, not that the result of it was so bad. Do you remember that bloke Ty with the high Jim voice? Ty. Yeah. He was completely useless. They put him at Dorset Square northbound. because you couldn't do anything with the 159s there except tell other people which buses they were. Actually, you could turn them just short of West Hampstead Station, but that's the only thing you could do. But he was an exception. There were some incredibly motivated people who were wrestling with these terrible problems of a service which with completely insufficient resource, and actually really doing rather well at it. And then, of course, having done that, I went to, as a garage inspector to Hull Iron Chalk Farm, and you saw the other side of it, which is people who are much better paid, who sat in the garage, observed caustically about what was going on outside, didn't actually really do much to help it. There were some pretty good people on allocation. There were quite a lot of people who regarded the whole of the outside world of the bus service as something that they'd managed to escape, and they were well paid to do it. The union rep was a bloke called Larry Dalzell, who was dripping in gold and obviously paid for out of his outrageous earnings. And they had a completely different view, didn't they? Which is actually, whatever went on outside, it was nothing to do with them. Their job was just allocation, paying the staff and taking the money. And that was a further lesson, because actually some of those people had worked really quite hard to get into a job which didn't much matter in the provision of the service. There is a lesson there, and it's not a good one, actually. And for a few brief weeks, I was a garage operating manager. I don't think I was a very good one, because you actually need you need a bit of gravitas, and you need to be a bit adult, and you need to you actually need to understand why people do things and not just what they do. And of course, behind some of the terrible disciplinary events that passed your desk were not only people trying quite hard not to do the job, but some terrible personal stories of people who actually were working perhaps when they shouldn't, who did it because they had no other life, and that was a real eye opener as well. So I'm gonna curtail some of that lot a bit, because there is a danger of rambling on and on about a very long time ago. I think the probably the right thing to do is to move to the sort of early 1983, 1984, and the one thing I think about that time was that, and it's not because Derek's in the audience, but I hope he thinks this isn't faint praise. It seemed to me in when I first joined in the late 70s and early 80s that by and large, at least the bus operations people at senior level had rather given up. They acknowledged that they were desperately short staff. They acknowledged that there were huge shortages of vehicles. I remember Eddie Dempsey, who did recruitment, he came to a whole series of Ralph Bennett's meetings accounting for the performance of recruitment. It struck me actually that the bloke was wringing his hands in anguish rather than doing anything about it, and that was fairly institutionalised. But actually, Derek and Frank and others, I think by the early 80s, spurred on by the transfer of LT into government ownership, had started to think that actually something needed to be done, and something did need to be done because the service was bloody awful, and. The tendering system, which is now good 32 years old, if my calculations are right, started then, and the fight back in London buses to try to make something of what was quite obviously an organisation that ought to change, but hadn't managed to started. I think that was the start of the revival. Now, one of the things that I said to Roger in the course of his book is, that I don't know afterwards whether you needed to have done some of the things that were actually done, in particular privatisation, or whether it would have been the case that you could have let the managements that emerged in the late 80s turn out and it would have been managed quite well in public ownership. You're never quite going to know that, and I'll say a bit more about that in a minute. But certainly that was about the time that actually I think that some spirit started to get back into the bus operations organisation about actually making it work better. And of course you had to, because the object of tendering was to destroy the monopoly, to teach the trade union a few things about real life, and to ginger up the management, and so it did. So Marcus was there by that time. I can tell some stories about him, but probably shouldn't until we've had a drink. But actually, Marcus was part of the of the fight back, and one of the things he did was to want to see some organisations which were different in terms of service provision. So I worked on the London Coaches organisation at Wandsworth for a bit, which was good fun. And then there were two ideas, one of which was Westlink, Stanwell Buses Limited. That was Jeff Chamberlain. Their base would have been in Stanwell, except he found a property which Marcus thought was too extravagant, so the base turned out to be somewhere else, but the company's name remained the same. And I worked with Brian Constable to do Roundabout. And thanks to a bit of connivance with the tender bus unit, actually the work that came out of the tenders in Orpington and in you know, South West London were big enough to sustain a different sort of organisation. And to give Marcus his credit, he allowed us a pretty free rein to set those things up. And it was good fun, and we went out to find some premises, and Roundabout was in two industrial units in an industrial estate in St Mary Cray, and we sort of started again, which was pretty brave actually. I mean, I think Brian Constable left to himself would have started everything again every Monday, but that's a bit extreme. But actually starting a small bus company in the outskirts of London with smaller vehicles, a new rate of pay for the staff and all that sort of stuff was a pretty brave thing for an old and arthritic organisation to do. And to give it some credit, it actually gave us all of the help that it could do, partially because anybody who didn't want to help actually was so lethargic that you could get round them anyway. So it was all right, you know. And actually the trade union in the end weren't bad, considering if they were bright enough they could have told that actually this was on the way to destroying a comprehensive set of pay and condition, one London-wide pay and condition. And in fact, I can't remember the guy's name, like a big guy from Plumstead, but we took him out and we all got thoroughly drunk, and we told him what the rates of pay at Orpington would be, and in the end he just chose to ignore it. I think it's one of the brightest things they ever did. He just chose to ignore it on the grounds that they knew that there was nothing they could win. If they didn't let it happen, they'd have lost all the work. And if they did let it happen, they certainly couldn't have been seen to connive. And it took me several days to recover from that that encounter up around in St James's Park, but it was well worth doing. And that, I think, is the origin of some much greater confidence in running a bus service. Some of those experiences weren't quite so easy. Harrow was good. Norbiton, famously, was rather less good. Small audience and probably never in writing. That's the only time. My brother is a QC, he does work for trade unions, and by and large he and I don't meet except socially, but we nearly met on that occasion because the TNGW took London buses to court, and actually if they'd responded to correspondence that I'd written with a bit more alacrity, actually they probably might have won that case, but I very narrowly avoided being a witness cross-examined by my brother, which probably wouldn't have been terribly good. But anyway, in at least in my head, that was evidence to me of a real change. And then we got on to the late 80s, where both privatisation and, as Roger's book says, deregulation were contemplated. A whole series of different plans for breaking up London buses in different ways, including groups of three and four garages. I think, again, I can see Derek in the audience, he must have had some influence, because Nicholas Ridley's view, after all, was that each employee with their own bus would run quite a good service. Complete nonsense. But actually, the smaller units you split it into, the less likely they were to survive. And in the end, 11 was quite a decent compromise. As history has proven, apart from one which was sort of, Roger himself knows all about that because he was the operations director, they did all survive. And that was really an interesting period, because the old corporate organisation morphed into companies of a measurable size that you could put your arms around, that you could find full direction. own it and take responsibility for it. Actually, as an aside, we're doing the same thing in Network Rail. It's not quite the same because a route of Network Rail is still a big beast. But actually, it's a lesson that I'm still repeating now, because actually turning huge businesses into portions that somebody can own and put their hands around is really good. And that's what we did. And I Centre West, which is a pretty awful name, but it was Unit 11 originally, and we were set up in late 1988. And there were four of us, and we did put our arms around it. And actually, I think that and the other companies proved to be fantastically durable, because you could actually own the outcome of what you did. Michael Stewart, Michael's not here, is he? No, Michael Stewart has reminded me several times since that he can remember the day in 1991, I think, when we first operated 100% of the mileage. Now, I can't remember that, it must have gone. But actually, if you think of all of the years in which London Transport had never been able, or when it wanted to or not, it was never able to operate all the bus mileage, suddenly getting to a position where actually you were operating the whole service, it was a good service. You could claim that you were really working hard and getting people within the organisation to own it. What was a real achievement, actually. And that in an era where we were also learning about costing, where actually tenders mattered, because you could lose work, and in fact, London Forest badly managed with some dud strategy, the company collapsed because it couldn't fulfil the tenders it had bid for. And that was all sort of real life stuff. We might save the 28 and the 31 and the midi buses for another occasion. But actually, though that scheme was conceived originally by Ken Blacker, actually, and I did much of the work in 1987 and 1988, I don't think there's any doubt we'd never have been able to pull off things like that without a devolved organisation. Because apart from anything else, the old organisation had a fixed capacity in recruitment, which was never going to be equal to the turnover of staff, and hence couldn't recruit enough staff. And actually, we did manage to do that. We put something like 200 people in the Westbourne Park in about 6 months for a garage which had seriously been threatened with closure about 3 years previously, because the old London-wide recruitment method had never been able to produce people for Westbourne Park, because inevitably they all lived in Eastcote, in Uxbridge. Well, actually, you were never going to do that. What you had to do is to recruit people from the Harrow Road, and that's what we did, and recruit refugees and other people. And I do think you can take your own views. I'm quite happy to argue about it. I think all of those companies thrived in a way that they would never have done. And actually, the directors of London Buses at the time took a lot of care to make sure that it worked. So the corporate organisation, actually, it stood back in two ways. It stood back because there were some people who didn't want to go to the companies, and they become, I don't know whether they thought they would retain their influence, but their influence diminished. But it also worked because the directors of London Buses supported that organisation and were committed to making it working. Roger's book tells a story. We were going to be deregulated. That's actually one of the reasons I got into small buses in such a big way. I can remember the day we finished the business plan for deregulation, which actually turned out to be the day that Stephen Morris stood up in the House of Commons and said it wouldn't happen. So as it turned out, the printer, we put it into the shredder. which is a pretty effective method of doing one sort of business. And that must have been right, mustn't it? If you think back on it, it must have been right. Whether you know a judgment about deregulation outside London is it depends roughly on where you live, and there aren't many places you live it's really done terribly well. But actually, who would have seriously come to it? And I think that's one of the best examples I know in my career of a political U-turn, which was absolutely the right thing to do, and then actually gave the companies a solid future, because on the back of it, Clive and Rodney and Derek and Norman and John set about allocating the remaining block grant routes that hadn't been tendered by them to the companies, negotiating some prices, and actually got quite a lot of money off, and we got businesses which were shaped up for sale, which had some pretty secure contracts, they had some pretty decent assets. And to my immense surprise, they were fundable, or financeable rather. And we in Centre West, we took a view which was that we would rather get the company ready possible. One or two of my colleagues took the view that they would buy it as it was and subbed it out afterwards. I think we proved that we were right, if only because actually it looked more dynamic. But we managed very successfully to finance not only a bank loan for the entire value of the vehicles, but also a significant amount of venture capital, which was based not on any asset value, but simply on the prospect of the management producing the plan that they produced. And we had a very interesting early 1994 going around to sell that plan to banks and venture capitalists, and in our case we were lucky enough to buy the company. I will sort of wind up in a little bit, because the clock's ticking on. One of the things that Roger didn't put in his book actually was that I don't think any of us, because we've never run, or I'd never run a commercial business, I knew about how you had to finance the company. I haven't been quite as punctilious about the cash flow, but what actually happened, safely you can tell this now because it's a good more than 20 years ago, and Clive's, bless his souls, has died, but we actually bought the company on September the 2nd, 1994, and what I hadn't realised, I think John's story had, but he hadn't told me, is that provided we bought it on the 2nd or the 3rd, we got the off-bus revenue for the previous 4 weeks on the 4th. And that was fantastic, because actually, within 48 hours of buying it, we wound up with a positive cash balance in the bank. It wasn't the money that mattered, it was the lack of debt, that, and I don't know whether somebody contrived it for us or not. But it was really very helpful, I'm grateful for that. And then, well, some of the more recent history in that era is all Roger's well documented, or the sale to First Group. I'm pleased I sold it. I'm sorry I sold it to them, but you don't know until afterwards. And I worked for Moya for 2 years, and then I came back to work for Ken in 2000. But I think the point of all of that is to say, and you know, Roger's developed a large part of it, and I'm told that Barry Arnold and Mike Harris are going to do a prequel, which is the sort of reshaping plan, and that will be really interesting too. What I don't think you can do is to pretend in the glorious world of history that it's all been very good and everything's just a continuous improvement. I think what I've learnt out of that, and I've been trying to use it ever since, is that you can fix things that are wrong, providing that you recognise that they are wrong. There's nothing that you need to accept as being inevitable if you're prepared to put yourself out to change it. And what I do think is that there's a lot being said about buses in London since 2000, and how the growth has happened. We could have done that in the circumstances in which the middle and late 1980s and 1990s hadn't happened, but it would have been infinitely more difficult and longer. And I think the credit that I would give for that period of time largely of Roger's book is that actually some senior people in London Buses did put themselves out, did decide that it was worth changing, put through some pretty radical changes in order to sort the place out for the future, and hence produced the foundations of what then, when I came back and worked for Ken in 2000, we were able to deliver, which was a better bus service. But I don't think it would have been possible to do that without a service where, by and large, people had learnt that you ran the service properly, you staffed it all, and you ran it properly, and that was the bedrock rather than an aspiration. And I think if I wind up at the end of this tunnel with any sort of management lesson, it's firstly that you can change things if you try hard enough, and you shouldn't accept what's there just because it's there. That's a message. And the other thing is that actually it's infinitely easier to build on it if the foundations are there in the right way and the thing's doing what you want it to do. And the bus service in London has since gone from strength to strength, not particularly through my effort, but through a whole number of people, of which I've led it for a bit. But we would have been, it would have taken us a lot longer to get there if those moves in the mid and late 1980s and 1990s hadn't been taken. And actually, then the last point is that actually sentiment is a great thing. So, you know, the glorious history of London Transport, all of the visual imagery and all of that, I'm as fond of it as you are. But actually, if you ask yourself, could you have achieved this much without radical change, including ownership and financing, it's quite hard to persuade yourself you could have done. I think if they'd left me in charge of Centre West for long enough as a publicly owned company, I probably could have done. But it is quite hard. And what I've learned since, in 15 years working for the Mayor and also now working for two Secretaries of State after only less than 2 years, is that actually in public ownership, it's always harder to do everything because you don't have any of the freedom of action that you would do in the private sector. And that's not a political comment, it's an observation of fact. And if you want a final word, if you want testimony of that, there's a really interesting, Michael Holden is a career railway person, wrote an article in Passenger Transport a few months ago because he ran East Coast Railways to Ripon into public ownership. And Michael was very proud of what he did. His conclusion was that he could have achieved it all at about half the personal effort and twice as quickly if it hadn't been owned by the government. So don't tell the Secretary of State that. Right, that's as much as I'm going to say because it's 7 o'clock.
Thank you very much. Can I ask Graham to take ownership of this noisy mic, if you would? We'll take some questions. I'll probably be a fairly passive chairman in this part because I'm sure Peter is big enough and brave enough to take questions himself. So anyway, who's got the first one? Derek.
Could I just say, at the beginning of the 1980s, we did two things. One was to break the stranglehold of the Schedules Office and try to produce schedules which were operable rather than theoretical.
Yes.
And the other thing that we did, I think it was over the Christmas of 81, we produced schedules which were something like 10% or 15% lower than actually to meet what staff we had. And so we got the beginning of being able to run what we planned. So I hope that started the challenge.
Yeah, it did, didn't it? Because actually, if my memory is right, and I was quite a young man, it's a long time ago, we were more senior than that, actually all those things started to contribute in the middle of the organisation. The thing that you might actually be able to get somewhere better than where you were. I'm getting a bit serious tonight, so I forgot half the anecdotes, but I mean, some of you will remember them. In the summer of 1977 or 8, it didn't run at all between South Kensington and Baker Street. The company decided they wouldn't go further in South Kensington. At the end, decided they wouldn't go west of Baker Street. So they did. And the 508, which was withdrawn by local arrangement completely, they took the in-place off the stop. It didn't run. Right? You know, that's the sort of act of desperation of people in the middle of the organisation, just thinking, oh my God, this is so bad, we've got to fix it ourselves. And I'm sure that you're right, actually. And actually, in these big organisations, it takes a long time to get back with them, actually. I can remember, way back in the late 60s, early 70s, I had an office next door to Norman Cohen, and we were sort of here.
Junior at that time.
And we used to stand in the corridor and we used to say, what ought to be done? And there was no hope that we would have been able to do it. And then finally we did.
Yeah. Well, good credit to you, more credit to you than to me. I've used the results, I think. Well, there's all sorts of things I should have said, but didn't I? Qualified some pictures of the car park the whole way.
Anyway, now, something you remember? As a rail buses, which is discovered to have been painted behind the rail buses.
People will drive out of one of them to go, throw the pipes over the railway fence, drive into the other, and go to the campaign. And poor old George Kempster killed it because all he did was say he was interviewing people who all could have been sacked. And anybody who wanted to do the job just sort of got on with it quietly. Which is why I don't think you can have a business that was all better in the old days. What I do think is that you should recognise the changes that people made on the way and actually.
You know, personally. The attribution of it is I think pretty fine actually. Now Leon was here, I'm pretty sure he would have been discussing it. So doing this quite regularly, one of which is that whilst we tolerated the progressive reduction of road space created by the desire to have more public space, also the Trafalgar Square, the Blue Skin, many others, and actually that made the margin. It's quite clear that the cycle super highway have made an enormous difference because they've taken out a large piece of road space. And in today's conditions, you can't compensate for that. All I can tell you is that actually, the engineers have done a beautiful job of doing it because it could have been done much worse. And B, if you've seen the original proposal before, they went to Boris. Actually, what's gone in is significantly less destructive than what we would have liked. But if you take all that road space that happened in central London,
you do get a result, and one of the things you'll see is the result.
It doesn't matter how pleasant you are with civilisation and all of the traffic measures that have been put into the building that's a significant proportion of road space in central London. The second thing is that actually there's a very substantial growth in small van deliveries. And not much is known about this subject, of course, there isn't much research on it. But some part of the chairman of the Secretary of Transport, who was abolished by a grateful
coalition government in 2010.
And one of the things we would have done had we survived is we would have made a little work about that. It's not about what they are, but about who owns them, what you bring.
Never really been done, but it's quite
clear that the central London road project is increasingly full of people in part of the delivery. And I went this morning to the onset of the same personal deliveries in the offices, which is probably quite a lot of cost sensible things to do, is massively inconvenient to drive everything to the
well, it's obvious that I don't live in Bath, and when I do, it's the weekends and cars get delivered. I'm never in a flat in London because I'm at work, so whether I live in Greenfield or not, I deliver to Waterloo. And so does everybody else, and that's what we're doing so much. And the third thing, and you'll have to bear with me in explaining it, is private hire vehicles, not just Uber, but private hire vehicles. And when PHVs were licensed in 2000, well, first licensed, it was legitimised in 2000, the legislation that was used to put them in. The mirror, so far as it's available, surpasses the typical of taxi legislation. So the thing about taxi legislation in London is there is no cap on the number of vehicles or licences. If you qualify for a taxi driver's licence or a taxi vehicle licence, then you meet the qualification that is quite strict in the taxi, you're able to have a licence. And that legislation is replicated in 2000. I don't know how many PHV drivers and vehicles we thought there might be. But in the early years of 2000, after we conducted the initial licensing process, it was about 40,000. What's happened since is that Uber has fired what passengers, some taxi drivers have paid. They've got a license, and they've got an operating license to be tested in quite a legitimate way. There's no reason to disqualify them because the other part of the licensing
cannot stop you. Fancy trying to stop him discriminating.
But the same is true of vehicles and drivers, so there are now, I think, 110,000 DOT driver's licenses for Central London is full of DOT drivers. And the other thing is that the taxi trade won't allow them on that. So what they do, they don't not come into London and drive around and around and around. Before I left, I think it's probably 15 before I said, oh, what are you going to do about this? And I said, well, actually, you can't do anything about it except with more legislation. Limiting the number of PHVs because of congestion. I think it's a completely legitimate
proposition
to limit the number of PHVs
because of congestion. But
Boris didn't want to get confused about the Commons when the MP before he got the government. He's now on, no longer the mayor.
I haven't seen any sign that anybody wants to do it. But actually, if you want
to limit, the only other limit on PHVs is an economic limit of people actually not making money. Interestingly, they still seem to be joining the market even though it's really hard to make any money. And so long as you've got those three factors, the traffic in Central London has got basically the worst bus service times in London. One of the last thing I found out, which I'm sure we understand here, is that actually so it's changed the algorithm, because what we're used to start on the bus service is that growth is related to
frequency and reliability. But now it's clear that German longer the
demand's dropped off because it's quicker.
You know, actually there are journeys I don't bother
making more time
across me. I'll walk down the Strand quicker than getting a bus because a lot of traffic that used to be on the embankments on the Strand, so what are you gonna do?
And I think it is true. It doesn't mean the bus service is broken. There are some things that can be done about it. I think you might see you don't finish the book about reshaping all the buses too quickly.
I think you might see some of the methodology of the late 1960s coming
back. Very short routes in Central London because they probably don't want to do it. But actually, the current model really doesn't work because you can see the people who are starting to move somewhere. They can't have the future. But what the long term relevance of that is probably legislative.
Which if
I'm not going to do that, I'm going to do that. I'm going to do that. I'm going to do
that. I'm going to do that. I'm going to do that. I'm going to do that. I'm going
to do that. I'm going to do that. I'm going to do that. I'm
going
as you know, I saw what was going on and moved it from afar. And looking at what went on outside of it, I'd always say that it wasn't the regulation that
made the difference.
It was privatisation. And privatisation made the difference because talented managers were liberated from over-centralised organisations and able to do the business.
In a way, as you said, you could put your arm around the organisation. So
that's a lot of very good question. The only question that I would be interested in your thoughts on,
suppose this had been different and Steve Norris had been the chairman.
Would it have made much difference to this election? So, well, I'm sure the first thing is right. I mean, what so I'm not the Mark Harmer is the chief executive. He derived this proposition for devolution before I got there. All I've done is
drop it on its way, as I continue to do.
Because actually, it's
which is very similar to what we're beginning to see. Last autumn, the board
said to Mark,
can see a result.
Get along. I don't know what they do. They're going to push back against the large corporate
organisations. say that's okay too.
Because actually, the result is a better railway than that. And I think that that is right. And actually, you can always, you know, I think if you ask people, they've got a right of maybe not in every year, just the entrance is still going. But you can do, I can see from quite a long way away, people who are beginning to say, yes, I am.
Let's get a bit of publicity and get Flying Scotsman out. He's absolutely right. And actually, in a couple of weeks' time,
Sunday morning, I'm taking straight third, about 5 o'clock in the morning, where I'm the East Coast mainline, North of York. We're going to have Flying Scotsman, HSP, Park 91, new construction trains, all travelling in the same direction, primarily. Rob McIntosh is very amazing that he's standing up. If I can do this, I'll take the full line possession. And I've got a Flying Scotsman for the railway here. It turns out I'm absolutely fantastic. That's absolutely what local control is about. And it's giving, and when you do that and you get a good result, then actually the funds that those people get, the people who work for them, the organisation, the business people who are
in charge of the railway. I think it does really make a difference.
So the second question is really interesting. I should have talked about my own lobby by that road. I think that the Kane was a remarkable man because
the day he took the job, he knew
what sort of London he was to produce. And the first London planning and transport
strategy were very good replications of what he wanted to do.
And in fact, if you like to compare the Forest Transport strategy, frankly, it's almost the same. And I think when he
finished his, it
would have been not much different. Which goes to say that I think Steve would become the mayor.
Something else then.
Steve would become the mayor. Then I think his transport strategy would have been
dissimilar. I think it's really important that
the part, it is important that the mayor's a politician. It's important that they are credible characters, big people. But whether their politics really matters in particular in this area is a bit more difficult to prove. Actually, the responsibility of the mayor is to create a long-term economic inflation rather than plan for
over 30 years, and then a transport strategy. Actually, if you're going
to develop a world city,
most of the things you want to do are actually the same.
Boris came in and decided that he said, why don't we go to Britain, pick up the building throughout the London Borough, about 4 or 5 weeks throughout the London Borough. He said, go that idea. I don't have that, whether he thought it was a good idea or not. By the way, they voted for it. So that was the end of that. And actually, his MPS is not appearing much. Which isn't to say that the mayor doesn't have influence, because the mayor does pass the message as far as he really wants. But actually to say that what you need to do in the world city is probably very similar, no matter what your politics are, bearing in mind where the city is going anyway.
So
high buildings, well actually Boris I think for a bit, so he didn't like them, but most of the right.
When it's Kendit, he did like them. And I think Sadiq will like them, and they've all got to like them.
Right, and pack everybody in the seat.
But actually, the reason that the Mail is such a worthwhile job is because it's not about political leadership primarily, it's about spatial and economic development leadership. And the principles that you would adopt for your spatial and economic development plan probably are not dissimilar. Some decent, substantive work to be done on that subject, because the real threat to London as a city since the Mail is because it's got a long-term plan, it's backed up with analysis, because business believes in it, and people are willing to fund it and actually carry it out. And that's a great thing.
Okay,
right
around the front of the
Wait for the mic because it helps.
About a year ago, the talk was all about, I think the quote was, turn South London orange, one of the things you do have to distinguish between if you want to stay in the job is that you know. Chris Grayling's there now. Will he be there till 2020? Don't know. My appointment lasted July 2019. Fair bet I'll be at least number three by then. Because that's the way it happens.
The best thing you could ever say to him is actually, you know, he's been doing
this with Boris sometimes. He said, well, I'm going to do this anyhow. You're a failure if you don't complete, and you're probably a failure if you don't get second.
So I hope to be thinking about years 5 to 8, because they're the years when they deliver something.
Transport terms, because everything
costs a lot of money, takes a long time before you get there. They spent 4 years waiting
until Boris started, and
but that permanence is very powerful, because it gives a different relationship.
Because in the end, he got it, you know, we're both going to be there. You say, and I said, I told him not to do it. I wouldn't say it quite like that, but it'd become obvious.
And actually, that's really powerful, because that does not happen in national government. The national government people start things in the full knowledge that things will be obvious. And that by the time they come to fruition, they'll be known. You know, if there's really a
an originator for the
It's Andrew Banks, who dreamed it up and announced that 48 hours in 2006, he's got no idea how much it cost, what it was, how much it was going to pay, and even miles away now, and we're about to get it produced from doing, you know, the response that is very continuous. And that is a national government system, so back in the property, did agree
that he would devolve the South Eastern to this, to the mayor, the previous mayor actually. The mayor's changed, the secretary's
Well, you can't, you know, whatever you think of the decision, it's not the ability
to take it.
What's difficult is that
those people change.
At a fairly fast velocity. And actually, the press, the media,
generally are fairly unquestioning
about the things that change
in those circumstances.
They're not surprised that the media say that people use the old one. But it may all change very significantly. Since we've had two men.
Done 8 years.
Actually, what you can see on the streets in the region, just wearing under the council, is a very consistent approach in the way that
is much harder to achieve in national government. I mean, the other thing, frankly, that happened
in national government is that
civil servants spot a Secretary of State who doesn't want to do what they think they ought to, they just put it in a drawer, wait for the next one.
If you want him or her to do something, you have to persuade them, because they're there for a long time, and in fact they might be there for longer than you are. It's a big difference.
And it's very powerful, and it's why London's done so well.
Absolutely.
Right in the middle there.
Yeah,
I can tell you.
It's pretty dark, actually. That's all right.
So the subtext could be
one thing you don't want that, and the other is because it actually deserves to be better.
It deserves a better audience, better audience, a better reputation than it.
But two bits of context, one of which is in one respect, a dream, believed in the organisation. It wasn't a dream in another way, it was a long way to my family, an old fashioned communist, and I never went to Kenya now, and what the answer was in the book.
Ask the question.
He didn't want to do anything for them. But hey, you know, he was directed. When Boris came, his general view was that a public service, a public sector organisation, couldn't possibly be run well. As a matter of political.
Philosophy, then you wouldn't wake up in the morning and say, God, that TFL, that's really good.
You wouldn't say that. You'd say,
people run that, they must be bloody useless.
So after we got over on the rock, we were going to keep it in the story itself, something else, and that's why I said, I'll tell you, but it's not. famous story we got through all sorts of things, including in his first
term, and we got through the Olympics.
Which is an obvious lesson in public sector, because he was so
captivated by
what we've done, he forgot to remember that he's supposed to criticise this for not being I'm being serious about that, because there is a political philosopher, and then actually Boris put his head around it and
decided. Not just because of that, but we that was year five by then, but actually we were all right. And
I remember every year we used to go through
ritual of him groaning at my performance related
pain.
I said, do you know what's wrong with this?
He said, oh, no. I said, why are you going out and say you've done a good job? He said, what do you mean? I said, why don't you say that the management has done a good job in this organisation? He said, Christy, baby, you know that'll work.
And we did do that, and actually we never heard a moan, because by and large people thought it was true. By and large, it's not like it's never true. So you're fighting against, certainly in some parts of the country, divide, people who don't believe in public sector organisations.
It
can be a good organisation. And by the way, quite a lot of the Labour Party doesn't clearly seem to know that they're involved in being nationalised in the public
sector. Yeah, John McDonald.
Improve on the railway. We got caught up in a similar failure and said things will improve after we've nationalised the railways. I said to him, I don't dare write to him and tell him they're already nationalised.
the other thing, so there's an object lesson in that, and the media respond in the same way. You know, actually, whatever it is, we're overpaid, we don't work hard enough to resolve that. So you sort of learn to live that with that.
But the other thing is,
that actually Network Rail, on that, has been through the most extraordinary change. It was part of September 2014, November 2014. It was allegedly
a private company, but
with no shareholders, but with unlimited access to government funds.
Yeah. So it behaved independently, it could spend as much money as it wanted, and it was unaccountable. Now, suddenly, overnight,
it's changed into a public
industry. It's hard with a going to do the right job, but we're working on it.
And it takes time. But if you say, is it worth it taking time? Of course it's worth it taking time, because the result ought to be the better one. And it's quite hard to do. I don't see any difference in attitude or commitment to the 35,000 people
working on the rail.
But there are 30,000 people working on the CFR. Most of them could earn more than something else, a lot of them turn out in crap weather and difficult places and do really hard jobs. By the way, the track worker on quite a lot of the network every so often, the train goes past and
sprays you with human effluent, which is
not much fun, including my people
on the mainline. And they work really,
really hard. And I don't think those people deserve
so I put myself
about.
I said, yeah, that's right. What do you want to tell me about the railway? Quite often,
we've got to
deliver stuff which is better, but why can't you do it? Why can't you do it? You've got to adopt the same spirit as we were talking about the bus service in the 80s, of fixing the things that are wrong.
And we are fixing the broken things. We're getting fine shots around the park. They're talking to the fine station is part of it. The park is fixing the heroic jobs. You know, which are pretty heroic jobs, actually. And I think exactly the same thing. So, you know, and what we mean is, well, the best you ever do is quiet. That's all you get. You won't get nobody's going to say, why can't they
do that? Now, rather than doing a good job in a public sector organisation,
they're not going to come in sometimes.
And that's what you have to live with. Hey, you know, after.
So it was a very strange time, because actually I met Boris twice before we left in 2008.
I met him because candidates are quite
hard to meet, because
they're busy being candidates. They're not interested in what they're going to do. They've got to get elected first. And when I first met him,
he was quite clearly in a mood of having a good time. If you remember, Steve Morris was absolutely outraged. He was furious. Boris,
they're stuck with. Because they, even if, whatever you think, they...
And then the momentous state came when you did get elected, and when the guy was sitting in front of us, sort of peering at me, and sitting on the right floor.
And he made a victory speech, and then he got a sort of...
Then he got me, but Ian Blair and the police.
He got Ron Dobson, who's the fire commissioner, and Manny Lewis, who ran the LDA. And...
To give ourselves some credit, I've worked it out.
Whether you could do it. That seemed to be quite logical. The mayor says, the potential mayor says this.
This is what he did. Ian Blair went first, he's got the best uniform. And he said, well, we're the police, we look after the city, don't you worry about that, mate. Which, as history unfolded, proved not to be marginally patronising, I would say. Ron,
committing himself to abolishing the LDA, I said, well, look, this is what you said you'd do, this is what we can do, and he hadn't been given one of them.
And actually, that was the first time that actually this relationship might be promising.
Because actually, he had no idea what to do in the first week of being elected. Drink ban? Well, here's a
little man,
Matt Kennedy, already. So when Boris came in, he
said, oh, good, I'm going to do it next month. And we did. Why wouldn't you do that? It's not Einstein. Anyway, we got on very well. But he got this great time for
quiet advice from people who said,
hence communism, elephant's history, it's pretty dodgy, you should fire. Now, the one thing that you probably could guess about Boris in my opinion is that he's got a very small
boy streak in him.
I didn't work it out
subsequently, that actually the more you tell him not to do something,
the more likely he to do it, and the reverse.
And actually what
happened was, all these Tories pressed down and said, God, the
payloads make uses, they make the
same. And in the end, I think what happened was, there were so many people who told Boris,
yeah, brilliantly, that he decided not to.
That's not to say that there was an instant trust, because what I've described before, it's still evident, which is that if you come from a political background, believing somehow that public sector institutions are not good, then it's hard for anyone to run
on to say this is good. But in the end,
we've got a long time, and actually, I think for those people.
Things that he could do.
And what you really realise is that politicians have to do something. They can't just sit there, they've got to do it.
You know, the first 100 days, well, actually you just ask yourself, what does the first 100 days mean? What does it matter? They've been elected for 4 years. But in media terms, what they say and do
matters.
And we had all of that stuff.
But we were actually,
we're all as fit as any other mayor, actually. No, it wasn't.
Like that, you didn't ask, right? But that, you know, all such stuff is real life. And of course, the other thing, which is very significant in different parts of the country, about the mayoralty compared to the government
institution, is
the mayor is pretty big on his own people. So if you read the legislation, 8+2, people who are advisors, 8
trusted advisors, and Boris didn't even come with any of them. But even if he had, he'd only had 8+2. I had 30,000. Find a structure like this in government, because in government you've got zillions of civil servants,
all of them are trying to balance what you should do and what you shouldn't
do and what the other party might do and saying things up for next time. And we didn't do any of that. Actually, my attitude was, it wouldn't have mattered who the mayor was, I'll tell him the right things to do. It's his choice whether to do.
And that too is a very different relationship from a national government perspective. You know, the civil service
and the politicians change.
With the mail, the mayor goes and people around him go, but actually the institutions which they don't control are more substantial
than the, than that little administration.
And whoever wrote that spoke to the amazing part of that administration.
Brilliant stuff, because that's the way in which you get in the end subject matter experts. And frankly, if the
mayor had, I was thinking it wasn't part of the other
get somebody else. It's all right. It is all right, actually.
That's the difference in being elected. But it's a good
story, isn't it? Well, I'm not sure I could
quite believe it either, actually. Several times I thought this is it, but actually, Boris is not very funny. He's also very clever. He's
also very loyal, actually. And
you'll be gone, but I know, and our organisation is going to play. And that's the right relationship. You can't have that sort of
five, then you're not.
I think I was right.
There you go.
Thank you. Let me go right back to what Peter said, two things Peter said at the beginning. This very much was not a date which was written for a speaker. It was definitely a speech as written for a date, which is why I was meeting an extra meeting about that more than fit. And the lack of pictures, well, many pictures in the presentation like that. Very amusing, very entertaining, very open, quite a few thoughtful things in there as well. We never got to move back. The friends are going to get to move back. We're coming in probably fairly large number. The original idea was by chance of the train, but somebody else had that idea first.
Yeah.
So we are now coming in increased pages. So many of you, if you so wish, will on the 26th of August.
Yes, certainly the 26th.
Join the friends and many others at Edinburgh. But I think we have actually said we will come back this Sunday today to talk about Edinburgh.
If you come this year, we've had to decide that it's now got so popular, we're not going to register a timetable between Warminster and Edinburgh, we're going to register a frequent soon.
Right, thanks
for
the whole bloody lot, exactly where we want.
Every 7 to 9 minutes. Right.